Right, good morning, everybody. On behalf of Madibaz Sport, warm word of welcome to everyone joining us this morning. Looking at the attendance list, I see some managers, some coaches from Madibaz Sport, some staff from Madibaz, from Nelson Mandela University, schools from around the Eastern Cape and Port Elizabeth, and then also representatives, coaches and staff from the Eastern Cape Academy of Sport. You all welcome and thanks for supporting us this morning. Just some rules. You're welcome to obviously submit questions. At the bottom of your screen, there is a Q&A section. So you're more than welcome to submit some questions. If time allows, we will request a response from our guest, Mr. Neil Powell. If we're not able to address it in the hour that we have, we will submit some answers to those questions via email. I think without further ado, I'm going to formally introduce our guest. I'm sure we will all agree he doesn't really need an introduction, but for formalities, there might be some things that you don't know about our guest. He achieved his honors in biokinetics after completing an HMS degree at Corsis. As a player, he was part of the Free State Craven Week team, both at primary school and high school. Senior provincial rugby, he represented Free State, Griqualand West, the Blue Bulls, as well as the Cats in the Super 14 rugby competition. He was a Sevens international player over a period of 8 years. It was a staggered 8 years. And he was leading the Blitzbox for a period of 3 years. He took over as Blitzbox coach in 2013 and still currently occupies that position. So following a very successful career, Neil took up the coaching post in 2013. He's enjoyed quite a bit of success with the Blitzbox, as we're all aware of. But just to remind you, the Blitzbox won gold at the World Games. That was in 2013. It was also the final time that the Blitzbox actually participated at the World Games, because they were invited to the Olympics from then. And as we all know, Sevens are part of the Olympics at this stage. They also achieved gold at the Commonwealth Games in 2014, bronze at the Rio Olympics 2016, and also bronze at the World Cup Sevens in 2018. The Blitzbox were runners-up for three consecutive years, 2013-14, 2014-15, and 2015-16 season. Winners of the RB World Series back-to-back titles, which they acquired in 2016-2017 and 2018 season. Obviously, due to the COVID pandemic, this season was cut short. There was about four events that could not be played and completed, and the World Series decided to allocate the season to where it was leading, topping the log at this stage, and it was New Zealand, where South Africa was a close second. Obviously, we know due to COVID, the Tokyo Olympics was also postponed from this year to 2021. Some awards that Mr. Powell received: he was named the HSBC Sevens Coach of the Year in 2018, and also SA Rugby Coach of the Year at the SA Rugby Awards in 2017. He's probably the calmest coach on the Sevens circuit, but reading some books, he does say that what people see and what's actually going on inside is like chalk and cheese. Without further ado, I'd like to welcome our guest for this morning. It's Mr. Neil Powell.
Thank you very much, Rian. Thank you for the introduction, and good morning to everybody from a very cold and wet Cape Town. Thank you for this opportunity to come and share a little bit about our system and what we try to achieve as a Springbok Sevens team, especially over the last few years. Still trying to achieve. I think the big thing about culture it's never complete. It's never 100% where you want it to be. I think there's always room for improvement. It is ever changing because of the personnel, some players leaving and some new players coming in. That definitely changes the culture in a team a little bit. But I want to share what we've tried to achieve over the last few years in terms of our culture. And thank you for the opportunity. I think before we get to team culture, it's really important for a coach or anybody that's heading up a group of people to have a philosophy, to have something that they stand for, no matter good or bad. And I think sometimes with success, but also with failure, you almost tend to lose your focus a little bit, or you almost tend to become somebody that you weren't when you started your coaching career, or you got that position or that job as a head coach. And I think it's important when you're successful and when there's times of failure that you actually go back to that philosophy and just remind yourself what you stand for and how everything started for you when you became that coach. And this is not just my coaching philosophy, but it's the coaching philosophy of every management member in our management. And it goes like this: if I create an opportunity to make you a better player, but not a better person, I have failed you as a coach and a mentor. So it's not just for us about developing the person as a player, but also to develop the person off the field. And I think the big thing for us is we know at some stage they will leave our system and they will be fathers or husbands or employers or employees. And we need to develop that part of their personal life as well, not just the player and make him a better rugby player, but to make him a better person as well. So if we talk about team culture and you look at the diagram on your right, those are the values of the Springbok Sevens team. So family, integrity, humility, diversity, excellence, and leadership. And under each of those values, we have a definition. So family for us is we're a band of brothers that fight for each other on and off the field. For diversity is we embrace diversity in our pursuit to be the number one team in the world. So for all those values, we have a definition. But I think before we get into the detail of it, I think in terms of a team culture, it doesn't just happen overnight. We discussed these values that you can see there in 2008 when Paul Tru was still the head coach and I was still one of the players in the team. And I feel like we've started the process of creating that culture in a meeting in Manly in 2008 where we decided on these values. We decided on our vision statement, which is pioneers of greatness, and we decided on our mission statement that was touching people's lives. But this culture almost for me got as close as perfect in 2016, 2017. And then a lot of our senior players left and we almost had to start all over again. So it's never a place where you can say, yes, our culture is now perfect. We can now sit and relax and that's it. I think it's a continuous thing that you need to work on to make sure that culture stays the culture that you want it to be. The important thing for me, for especially players and all the members of the team to buy into this culture, is to have it all inclusive, meaning that when you start this culture discussions, everybody must sit into those discussions. The players, the whole management, everybody that's part of the system or part of your system must be included in those discussions. Because the great thing for me about it is, or the thing about it for me is, then they buy into it, but also then you can keep them accountable. If they maybe comes late at a meeting, then you can say, listen, but we've discussed it in the culture meeting. Being on time is part of our culture. So this is not acceptable. So I think it's really important for everybody to be included, but also then to revisit that culture. So for us, every single year before the season starts, and this is normally the time, say September, October, November, where we basically have our off season and pre-season. And every single year we revisit these cultures and say, guys, are we still a family? Is integrity still part of our culture? And I think one of the things that we've changed is the mission statement, touching people's lives, and we change it to inspiring hope. We feel not just by the that we can inspire hope for South Africans, not just with how we play on the field, but also how we conduct ourselves off the field. And it's one of the key things for us is It's not just about the rugby player, but it's also about the person off field and how we can actually help to make that player a better person as well. So in saying that, if you look at most of the successful or more rugby teams than sporting teams, they are really big on culture. I think for a very long time in South Africa, the Lions from Gauteng was a really good example of a team that looked like they're a happy bunch and they've got a good culture. And I think they've been successful for quite a few years. But again, then a lot of management left, a lot of players left, and then everything's changed a little bit. We can even go further and talk about Saracens, the UK-based team. They even went as far as putting their values on the roof of their stadium so that when people come and watch them, they can see exactly what they stand for as a team. And the fans can basically keep them accountable for those values and that culture. So we were so, that values and culture for us was so important. In 2016, when we opened our doors for players like Brian Abana and Francois Hougaard to come into our system, trial out to see if they can make it to the Olympics, we promised our current contracted sevens players, the Sissel Africas and the Carl Browns and the Philip Snyman's and Frankie Horns, that if those players come in and they don't contribute to our culture, we don't care how good they are and how many tests they play in 15s, we'll send them home. So that's how strong we felt about our culture when we opened our doors in 2016 before the Olympics. And I think I mentioned it a little bit earlier as well. I think that 2016, 2017, 2015, in terms of our culture, I felt we got the closest that we ever have been in terms of a perfect culture, but it wasn't perfect yet. There was still a massive room for improvement. And because that culture was so close to perfect, I think what was important for me was that 90% of that culture was driven by the leadership group, the senior players. So we don't just have a captain and a vice captain. We have a leadership group that is the link between the management and the players and the players and the management. So sometimes the younger players are a little bit scared to mention stuff or to bring stuff up. So they can actually just talk to the senior players, and then the senior players will come to us and say, listen, one of the junior players felt like this wasn't a good way to do things, or this is wrong in the system. And then we can again talk to the senior players, and they will take it to the academy boys and the junior players. But I will say that percentage has probably changed a little bit because of the experienced players that left and the inexperienced players that comes in. So for the management in the 2016, 2017 years, we probably just look after a culture for the top 10%. So when players are coming late, that leadership group will pull the player aside and go, listen, this is the last time that you're late. But obviously, if it happened a second and a third time, then obviously the management and me as a head coach needs to step in and go, listen, there's going to be trouble if you're going to be late again. So, but I'll say that percentage probably changed to 70-30. 70% is the leadership group and 30% the management, just because of the experience we've lost over the last few years. Values is not worth the paper that it's on if the top management, the top, the senior players live this culture. So we can't expect the 19-year-old that just came into the academy to be on time. If I'm not on time for meetings, we cannot expect the 19-year-old to unpack the bags of the bus if the management, when we're on tour, don't unpack the bags of the bus. We can't expect the 19-year-old to fill up the water bottles if the Sissel Africas and the Philip Snyman's and the Carl Browns don't fill up the water bottles. So if you don't live this culture at the top level, management and senior players, then these values on the right side of the screen isn't even worth the paper that it's on. So what we say in a system, it's never about the individual. It's all about building the legacy of Springbok Seven. So we have a saying that goes, in 20 years from now, nobody will even know who's Neil Powell or Sissel Africa or Carl Brown or Sevuye Sojwapi, but everybody will know Springbok Sevens, and Springbok Sevens will still exist. So everything that we do, it's not for my own gain or the assistant coach or the captain or some of the leadership group players, but it's actually all about building the legacy of Springbok Sevens. And then It's obviously we all human being, and if we're successful, it's always difficult to get the balance right between culture and success. So obviously, from a SA Rugby point of view, if we tell them, listen, we've came eighth in the World Series, but we are making better people of the players that's in the system, they're going to say, listen, we're not worried about the better people, we need results from you. So it's sometimes difficult to get that balance between how much does success weigh and how much does culture weigh. And I think for us as a management, it's a lot bigger compliment when people that gets to work with our players come to us and go, listen, we just want to congratulate you. You got such a great bunch of young men with good manners, respectful and disciplined, rather than somebody coming up to us and go, well done, you've won a tournament and a World Series. So that culture for us is a lot more important than the success on the field, but we sometimes do get it wrong. So again, I think from my side, with this presentation, is this is what we strive for. We don't always get it right, and it might sound fantastic and great, but it's a continuous process, and we also get it sometimes. We get it wrong, and I, in my 7 or 8 years as a coach at this system, I definitely at some stage also almost chased the success more than the culture and the team. So, what are the everyday things that we do that's the foundation for this culture? And I think the very first thing is there's no hierarchy in our system. So what it means is if I'm the head coach of the team, walks past the 90-year-old that that fill up the water bottles and he's by himself and there's 20 bottles to fill up, the system expects of me, the head coach, to stop and help this 19-year-old to fill up the water bottle. So what it means is your title doesn't exclude you from the day-to-day duties and activities inside the team. So if you're the head coach or you're the captain or you're the assistant coach or the manager or the physio or the doctor, that doesn't exclude you from the day-to-day activities, from filling up the water bottles, carrying the cooler bag across, carrying the tackle bags and the shields. Those are, everybody is included in those duties. So for me, you can't have a culture if there's no discipline, because for me, discipline is almost gives you the boundaries wherein the players can function and can live the cultures and the values that we've given them. So, and that culture, that discipline, if you're ill-disciplined off the field, it carries over to on-field as well. So for me, in my opinion and my belief is you can't have a culture if there's no discipline in your team or in your system. So work ethic, and work ethic for me is almost the same as serving people as well. So it's about helping the players to fill up water bottles. It's about them helping me to put the bags away. It's about them helping to take the bags off the bus when we're on tour. But it's also in the seven system, work ethic is key. And I think we had a lot of talented SA Schools players that came into our system, but when the hard work started, they unfortunately just didn't have the work ethic to stay in the system, and they left by their own choice. They left the system because it was just too hard work for them in terms of what the demands were of Sevens and still is. Learning curve, really important for us as well as that learning curve. We can't coach you one thing three times over and over again. We expect you that if we coach you one thing, that the next time you must be able to implement it. And again, we will maybe give you a second chance as well, not just one chance, but after the second time that we've coached you something, we expect you then to implement that what we've tried to coach you. And integrity. And I think if there's two values, in my opinion, when I teach my two boys, Joshua and Caleb, it's integrity is one of them, and then respect is the other one. So for us, the definition for integrity is to do the right thing when nobody's watching. So in our system, if we played a tournament and we're the last, we leave the change room and you're the last player that leaves that change room. And when you get to the door, you turn around and you see, but there's empty bottles and there's empty and there's plasters lying around. The system expects you to turn around, pick up the empty bottles and plasters, put it in a bin, and then you leave. Even if nobody knows you're the last player that left and there's still bottles and plasters left in the change room, the system expects of you to do the right thing when nobody's watching. So men of promise, And again, it's to promise that you will give 100%, 100% of the time, and not 90%, 100% of the time, or 100%, 90% of the time, but to give 100%, 100% of the time. And I think it's not just for tournaments, but almost creating that habit of 100%, 100% of the time, every single day when you come into SAS and you start training day, is to give 100%, 100% of the time, and not 90%, 100% of the time. And then second last, I think there's two words for us: enjoyment and fun. And we have also, again, two definitions for it. So fun for us is something that the players can have off field. And a definition for fun is a five-year-old birthday party where there's kids running around. It's noisy, it's chaos, there's no purpose. They've got their red rings around their mouth because of the cool drink they had. So that's fun, and the players have it. They will put sleeping pills in each other's coffees when we get onto the plane. Then obviously the guy fall asleep, and then they will take a permanent mark and draw stuff on his face. So when we get off at the airport the next morning, he's walking in the airport, everybody's laughing at him, and he's got no clue what's going on. So that's fun, and the guys must have it off field. And I think it's an important component of a team's culture. But as soon as we get to the field and they put their boots on and their playing jerseys or their training jerseys, that fun must go to enjoyment. So there's a little bit more focus, there's a little bit more concentration, but the key thing for me is there must still be smiles on the faces. If we get into the work part of it, or to the training, or to tournaments, and there's not smiles on the faces, then we know there's something wrong. And then lastly, an inside-out approach rather than an outside-in approach. So what I mean is there must be something inside of you that drives you to be the best that you can be, that drives you to work harder than anybody else, to be the number one in the world, to be the best kicker in the world, to be the best defender in the world. But there must be something inside of you, rather than somebody looking over your shoulder and go, yes, Carl Brown, have you done your rehab? Philip Snyman, have you done your extra individual skills? Cecil Africa, have you done your recovery? So that inside-out approach is for us really, really important, so that we as a management don't have to, or coaches, coaching staff, don't really have to look over the player's shoulder the whole time and say, have you done this? Have you done that? So, and inside this culture, again, what is really key and important for me is a trusting relationship. So, and there's three components for me that builds this trusting relationship. And the very first one is respect. And I think a few years ago, I think it's about 4 years ago, we got taken to Monaco to coach on a 12 team in Monaco. So myself and Maurice Koeman, but it was this wealthy businessman in Joburg. And I only met this guy for the very first time at the airport, and then we flew over to Monaco. And then the very first morning, as I walked down to breakfast, this wealthy businessman, and he's about 15 to 20 years older than me, was sitting at the table already. And as I came closer to the table, he actually jumped out of his chair to greet me with a hand and go, "Morning, Neil, how are you? Have you slept well?" And I was like, "But why are you getting up? I mean, you're a billionaire. You're 20 years older than me, and you're getting up to greet me at the breakfast table." And I think the lesson that I took from that day is, and I always thought I was a respectful person, but it's easy to respect up. So meaning it's easy to respect somebody that's older than you. It's easy to respect your boss that you're working with, the person that you're working for. But it's sometimes difficult to respect down. It's difficult to respect a 19-year-old coming into your office and then have to get up and greet him in the morning. It's sometimes difficult to respect the lady that makes the coffee, or that cleans your office, or that cleans your room. So the lesson that I took that day was, it's easy to respect up, but it's always difficult to respect down. And from that day on, when that 19-year-old walks through my office door, I'll get up off my chair, greet him with a hand, and say, "Morning, hope you're well, hope you've slept well." So that respect thing for me is key to a trusting relationship, and trusting relationship is key to building a culture in the system, and not just between me and the players, or the players and the management, but management between each other as well, and also the players between each other. So the second component that I feel builds a trusting relationship is an open door policy. So meaning obviously open door in my office for any player to walk into my office and say, listen, I've got maybe personal issues. This is what's happening. Can I be excused from the session? And I think not just be available in your office, but also be available on your phone. So I do have a policy when I go home after five that I leave my cell phone one side and I don't answer anything unless I know it's emergency. And that's normally the players also know they don't bother me after five because then I spend time with my family and with my wife. So and I think the biggest compliment I got one day is when one of my senior players actually phoned me over a weekend on a Saturday morning, and he said to me, listen, coach, I've been in an accident. I'm okay. The other person is okay, but I just wanted to let you know, so that you don't hear it from anybody else. And I think it was such a big compliment for me, because immediately I knew that there was a trusting relationship between me and that guy, that he can actually phone me. That I was the first call that he made after the accident and said, listen, I've been in an accident but I'm okay and the other person is okay. And then the last thing is honesty. Shush. And I think it is difficult. I think it is difficult. And I think for any coach, the most difficult day of the year is when you sit one-on-one with the players and you tell them whether they made a team or not. And especially the one-on-ones for the Olympics, which is obviously the pinnacle of any, I think, sports person's career is to go and play in the Olympics. And I think that was probably the toughest day for me in terms of those one-on-ones. And I think just to soften the blow, you want to put a little line there just to say, listen, this is why you're not in a team, but it's not the truth. And I think if you do that, your credibility is out the door, and that trusting relationship between you and that player and basically between you and the whole system is gone, because they do talk to each other and they tell each other what's been said in that one-on-ones. Although it's not just you and that guy that's sitting on that one-on-one, they do talk to each other. So that honesty for me is something that I actually learned from Chester Williams, that when I was a player and he was still the seven coach, and he told me, sometimes he told me, sorry, you're not in a team because this is the reason, and it was the reason. And then sometimes he selected somebody else, went to a tournament and came back and he said to me, yes, Neil, sorry, I must apologize. I should have chosen you for this tournament and not that person. So, and I really appreciated that honesty, and it's something that I took on board in my coaching career as well. So in terms of the culture, what is our on-field focus? And I think, what do we focus on when we're going into to a tournament? And for us, winning is a swear word in the system. So we'll never go to a tournament saying we want to win a tournament. We talk about success. So we're not talking about winning. We talk about success, and we determine success by implementation of the processes. So what's your job? And if you do that, your job to the best of your ability, and then the effort you put in, because we believe if the effort is good and the implementation of the process is good, then obviously the results will look after itself. And that's the success we're talking about. So let's make it practical. So about, 4 years ago, when we played Spain in the quarterfinal, and we had to beat Spain to actually win the World Series. So we had to beat Spain and New Zealand in the semis and England in the final. And if we managed to do that, we won the World Series, and we eventually did. But in that game against Spain, it actually took us extra time to beat Spain. So were we successful? No, we weren't. Why not? Because it's either a lack of implementation of the processes or a lack of effort. So we were definitely not happy after that Spain game. Even though we pulled it through at the end, we weren't happy because it was either lack of effort or lack of implementation of the processes. But about 3 or 4 years before that, we lost to New Zealand in the final in Wellington. Yes, we weren't happy, but I felt like the effort was good and the implementation of the process is good. So But on a day, we got beaten by a better team, which is New Zealand. But as long as they know and we know that the next time we'll meet them, it's going to be different. So it's never for us about the results. We've won games in the past that we were not happy afterwards. And then we've lost games in the past when, I won't say we were happy, but we were satisfied with the effort and we were satisfied with the implementation of the processes. Then for us to have confidence going into a tournament, we say that we must be happy with what we call pa and ma. So, and for each of those letters, there's a word. So the first one is preparation. So for us, preparation is based on this quote by the Russian special forces that go, under pressure, a person seldom rises to the occasion. He always defaults to his highest level of preparation. So meaning that when you in the heat of battle, you're almost never going to rise to the occasion, but you will always default to your highest level of preparation. So we can't make the trainings easy and the tournaments difficult. You must make the training sessions difficult so that the tournaments and the games can be easier. It's never going to be easy, but easier. So if you think a player will find himself in a certain situation, or this game of sevens will test them mentally and physically in a certain way, then you must put them in that same level of challenge that the game will challenge them, probably plus another 10%, to make sure it'll be able to handle those situations. So you can't make trainings easy, but then the games are difficult. You must make the trainings difficult so the games will get easier. The first A is ability. So obviously we'll go out and scout the players that we feel is able to play this game, but we also then coach them and equip them to be able to handle the situations that they will come up against in on the field. Then motivation. And I think in the past we always used to make these motivational videos, and I'll show one of those videos to you at the end of the presentation. But we almost went away from it and said, listen guys, what motivates me doesn't motivate you. So everybody gets motivated differently. And we almost left the motivation to the players so that they, because for me, it could be success. For somebody else, it could be money. For somebody else, it could be a fancy house. For somebody else, it could be the fame that goes with the whole rugby playing careers. But so that motivation we left to the players, and we said, listen, we're not going to make these videos anymore. The motivation is now your responsibility, so you must make sure that you're ready for each and every single game, but also for each tournament. And then last thing is attitude. So it's not everything we do, we measure the effort and the attitude. So for instance, tackling, it's not just about making tackles or missing tackles. We also measure the attitude in tackles. So we almost prefer you missing a tackle, but you showed attitude, than making a tackle, but there's no attitude. So that attitude for us is weighs quite a lot in terms of our pa and ma, but also in terms of our confidence. If we can tick all four of those boxes before we go into a tournament, then we feel like, okay, we're confident to go out there and hopefully do well. So one thing that we also do is to actually write tests. So the week, especially the week leading up to a tournament, we'll write tests with the players, and for them to pass, each and every single person in that test must get 80% or higher. So if one guy fails, then we write again we write a test again the next day, not the same one, a different one, but they will write a test again. And strangely enough, a lot of the senior guys, as soon as you say test, they start to get nervous. So if you talk to them about the game plan, they will tell you exactly what's going on. But as soon as you write the test, then they almost start getting nervous. And they were, once or twice, they were the reason why we had to rewrite the test the following day. And it's not just about the what, but it's about the how as well. So how will we defend if a team attacks like this? And how will we attack if the team defends like this? So for a coach, that test is really important for me, because that's the only way I can find out where the players are exactly in terms of the game plan, in terms of the understanding what we want to achieve. By just asking it in a meeting and one guy answers, I only know that one guy is on the same page as the rest, or as what I want them to be on. But if we write a test, then I can know exactly what's happening. So they will write the test, and then we'll swap booklets, and then they will mark each other's marks or tests in the team meeting room, and then we'll get the results back immediately. So looking after the system, and the system will look after you. So we know if the guys implement their roles and responsibilities on the team, the system is designed to look after the individual. So, and what we've said to the guys, especially in defense, I think attackers are a little bit more creative and a little bit more playing what you see in front of you. But in defense, you have a certain job if you're in a certain position in the defensive line. And if you look after that system, if you do your job to the best of your ability, that system then is designed to look after you. So, make sure that you look after the system. And lastly, the system is doing well when there's smiles on their faces. So you can see Roscoe in the picture there. And again, a little story. So I think it was about 4 years ago, we lost to England in Cape Town in the final. And then the very next tournament was Sydney. I think it was January. So Cape Town was in December. And then end of January, we played Sydney. So we had England in our pool. We drew to them in a pool game. And then we got them again in the final. So our build-up towards a game will be, we'll have a team meeting, and then the players will have about 10 minutes where they put their boots on and their warm-up jerseys on. Then we'll go out to the warm-up, come back. They will change into their playing jerseys, get into the huddle, pray, and then go into the field. So in that specific tournament in Sydney, our cubicle was right across the door of the bathroom. And that 10 minutes between a team meeting and a warm-up, the players will normally put on a thing that they call a boombox. They will put their R&B or house or whatever music they will put on, and then we'll start dancing. So Roscoe will start dancing, and Siabella will start dancing, and even Chris Dry will start dancing. And I remember in that 10 minutes, I walked out of the bathroom and behind two English guys. And as they walked out of the bathroom, they could see our players playing music and dancing. I mean, but it's about 20 minutes before we play them in a final. And I could see the one English guy tapping the other one on the shoulder and go, what are they doing? And I actually wanted to tap him on the shoulder and go, listen, if they're in that mood, you're going to be in trouble today. We beat them 29-14 in that final. And again, I think it's just because of the fact that the guys had smiles on their faces. They were enjoying where they were. Where sometimes when the guys are sitting and they're nervous and their knees are hopping like that, then I know we're in trouble because the guys are too nervous. They almost close up when they're that nervous. When they're like dancing and their smiles on their faces, almost like their vision is better. They get themselves in a better space as well. So we know that enjoyment for us is key, and dancing is a big part of our culture. So the very next tournament, we actually played Fiji in the final in Wellington, and the players had a dance-off. So all 12 guys were in a circle, and one by one, they came into the circle and they showed their moves. And we also won that final against Fiji the very, very next weekend. So in 2016, we decided to develop a team ID. So a team ID for us is people must say this about us without we telling them this is what we stand for. So we have an on-field and an off-field. So off-field is very much our culture. It's not just being ambassadors for Springbok Sevens, but for South Africa as well, and then better together. But the on-field one is, so when teams play us or when people watch us play, they must actually say, listen, South Africa is a defense team. They're a contact dominant team. They're a composed intensity team. They set face dominance, out of the box, in the box, and work smart. So defense team is all about, and it's a little bit technical and tactical in terms of rugby. So sorry for the ladies out there, but defense team is all about making your tackle. So tackle completion of 82%, and all the teams that plays against us must know, guys, if you play South Africa, you're going to have to work to score tries. They don't just give freebies away. Contact dominance. And again, if you look at a South African team versus a Fiji team or New Zealand team or even America team, we by far the smallest, physically the smallest team on the circuit. And we need to work really hard for our players to be dominant in contacts, dominant in tackles, dominant in clean. So on a Monday, we have a wrestling session that the players had. It's a 45-minute session, but in terms of intensity and effort, it's a 9 out of 10 session. So they hate that session, but they also actually like that session as well. And it definitely helps them a lot in terms of their contact dominance. It helps a Brankett Aprile that weighs 74 kilograms to smash a Fijian that weighs 105 kilograms. Compose intensity, it's all about pushing intensity because we're a smaller team and we feel we're fitter than the Fijians and the New Zealanders and everybody else, but then not to make mistakes, to still control the game. So not to make basic errors like knock-ons or forward passes or bad passes, but to push the intensity, but also to have still control of the game. So many times at the halftime, we had to walk into the huddle and go, guys, let's make a step down in intensity and a step up on the control so it's more or less even. Sometimes we just trying to push the intensity too much that we make quite a bit of mistakes. Set phase dominance is just, your scrums, lineouts, and kickoffs must be yours. You can't lose any of those. So 100% right there in terms of the set phases, and then the out of the box, in the box system. So for us, the system is a big box, and that box lid must be closed. And then inside that big box is a lot of small boxes, but they're in free space, and that's the players. But those small boxes lids must be open. They can't sit in their boxes because they're fear of failure or they worry that they make mistakes. We want the players to get out of their boxes. And in that free space inside this big box, which is the system, they must function. So they can't get out of the big box as well and then try stuff that's not part of the system. But if they move into that free space inside the box, inside the system, we want them to chip and chase. We want them to try something that they feel was on because of what they've seen on the field. So sometimes we'll go out and scout players for the individual brilliance. But as soon as they come into the system, we put them in a box and we tell them, you must kick now, you must pass now, you must run now. But for us, we try to create a system where the guys can still bring out the individual brilliance when they play on the field. And then lastly, it's just work smart. So to basically outsmart guys. It's not necessarily always needed to work harder. Sometimes you just need to work smarter as well. And that's what we try to do. We try to outsmart the teams as well. And then just quickly, I'm just going to quickly run through this. And it's just the role of a psychologist or psychology in sport and in sevens especially. So when I was still a player, we had a lady coming into us and talking to us about the psychology part of the game. And she actually asked us the question, how much of rugby is physical and how much is mental? And some of the players said, well, 70% mental, 30% physical. Some of the players even went as far as saying it is 90% mental and 10% physical. And then she asked the question, so why do you spend 90% of your preparation on the physical and only 10% on the mental? And it actually made a lot of sense for me when she asked me that question. So we have a consultant as a psychologist that actually work with the players on clinical psychology, so meaning their own personal issues as well. So, but also to help them in one or two principles that will help the players on the field. So the very first, or one of the principles, is getting back to zero. So the whole idea about getting back to zero is, and he explained to us with Nadal, he said, Rafael Nadal, a tennis player, if he wins a Grand Slam on a Sunday, on Monday morning, 6:30, he will have a gym session with his trainer. But 6 o'clock, Nadal will go to the gym by himself and then have a tough cardio session to get him back to mentally get himself back to zero. So you must do something physically to mentally get yourself back to zero. So for us, in the sevens team, Monday, Tuesday, the guys are still stiff after the tournament. So when you win a tournament, you'll sit on +5 or +4. When you do badly in a tournament, you will go -3 or -4. But before you go into the next game or the next tournament, you must actually get yourself back to zero again. And the only way you can do it is to physically do something to mentally get you back to zero. So for us, Monday, Tuesday, the guys are still sore and stiff. But on a Wednesday, we will drop them at the gym and we'll say, listen, go to the gym and you can do whatever you want. You've got 30 minutes. So for a guy like Werner Kok that's aggressive, he will put his boxing gloves on, hit the punching bag, stretch, and he's done. Philip Snyman will run on the treadmill, cycle a bit, and then he's done. Justin Geduld, will just sit and stretch because he's so chilled and laid back. So again, it's individualized, and they must do what work for them in terms of the physical exercise that get them mentally back to zero. And then another principle is three times six is 18. So three times six can't be 21 or 15. So when you play New Zealand or you play Japan, the effort and the process must always be the same. You can't have less effort because you're playing Japan, you think it's going to be easier. So be complacent because you think it's going to be easier than have lesser effort, or you're not implementing the process. And you can't do more because you're playing New Zealand. The effort and the process must always be the same. Whether you play New Zealand, whether you play Japan, or whether you play England, the effort and the process, implementation of the process must always be the same. And that's why we say three times six can't be 21. So if you're New Zealand, you can't have a bigger effort or better implementation of the processes. And three times six can't be 15. So when you play Japan, it can't be less effort or a weaker implementation of the processes. Three times six is always 18. So your effort and the standards must always be the same. And then lastly, and I think this is probably the biggest thing for me, it's just that focus. He keeps us accountable to focus on what we say we want to focus. So for us going into the tournament, we always talk about focusing on one game at a time. So you can't play you can't focus on the final if you haven't played your pool games yet. I mean, you might not even get to the final. And we even explain it to the guys in terms of climbing a mountain. If you don't look down and look at your feet the whole time, and focus on the next step and the next step. If you look up and you look at the summit because that's where you want to go, you might trip over the next rock and you will never get to the summit. And that's exactly for us in terms of our game as well. We can't focus on, say, New Zealand and the final pool game if we haven't played Japan and Wales in the first two games yet. All our focus must go in the very first game. And if we're done there, we can shift our focus to the next one. So that focus on the next step is really key to us. This is basically my presentation, guys. I will show you about a 6-7 minute video, motivational video. So these were one of the videos that we created for the guys and showed the guys before we play a tournament so that we can get their motivation up. But we've decided to go away from it. But I think just looking at this video, look at the smiles on the faces, look at the brotherhood, and just look how the guys are playing for each other and really enjoying each other's company on the field. So here we go. Yeah. Yeah, so I think just it's always puts a smile on my face when I watch that video, just to see the effort and to see their smiles on their faces and the brotherhood and how they just enjoy each other's companies is amazing. So thank you very much. Hopefully, there was something that you can take from this presentation. So thanks a lot for inviting me. Thanks that I can share what we've tried to achieve and. And thank you. If there's any questions, then I'm happy to take a few before we finish up.
Thank you, Neil, for providing insight into what makes the Blitzbok stick in terms of the successful team culture has built over the years. I think it's evident in terms of, as you say, not only winning trophies, but the success that the team has had over the years. Looking at the Q&A, I don't see any questions from my attendees. I maybe would just like to bounce one or two questions off you there. During the 2013 to 2016 period when the Blitzbok lost and ended up runners-up for three successive years, once against New Zealand and then twice against Fiji, how do you manage to turn that around? Because obviously you just came in as a coach from 2013. Every time the team basically just fell short at the final hurdle. How did you turn that around? Because obviously 2016 was followed by back-to-back wins in 2017 and 2018. If you could just share that with us, please.
Yeah, I think obviously devastated every time we came short. And I think the first year we came second by quite a margin. And then my second and third year, every year we came closer. And I can remember even the second year, we were still in it with the last tournament to go. And then we performed badly in that tournament. I think we didn't even make it to the cup semi-final. We went into what they call the plate, I think, that way back then. And then lost in that quarterfinal in the plate as well against Scotland in Scotland. So and I can remember especially that second year that we were so devastated with coming second. And I think it was a case of keeping the guys motivated, but also because you took over from somebody else, I felt like there was still one or two things and escape, maybe one or two players that was at the end of their career and would start to build a new career. And I think in terms of, especially 2016, I think we again got to the point where I felt like the culture came as close as it ever been to being perfect. And then also in terms of the players and the personnel that we had. And so it was a case of almost building that first two or three years towards a point that we want to be at. And I think we managed to achieve that in that 2016, 2017 season. Everything just fell in place. The squad was a really good squad. It was an experienced squad. So there wasn't a lot of inexperience in there. So even if somebody got injured, the next guy was ready to take up that role and position in the squad. So I think it was just a case of building that experience and building that squad that then gave us success 3 or 4 years after I started coaching.
Okay, thank you. I see there is a question that's popped up here. Do things like breathing exercises and meditation, do you do that possibly as a team event, or is it left to individuals?
Yeah, so interestingly enough, and I think what's probably referred to as the breathing in at halftime, and I think that was something that was started by Paul Drew when he was still a coach. We actually did yoga in that time, so he got a yoga teacher in, and I think it was at least once a week we did yoga, and the breathing was part of it. And I think it's something that we felt definitely contribute to our success, and it became part of our culture, especially at halftime, because it might happen that somebody just before halftime, we might have defended for 40 seconds and the guys are tired. And just to come in, take two deep breaths, almost slow down the heart rate, get the bloods from the quads and the glutes and all the big muscles back into the brain so that the guys can open up the ears and eyes and listen to the instructions that we try to get over at halftime is quite key. But I think it's definitely something that we want to pursue again, is that a little bit, and something that we've done in the past. We haven't done it since I was coach, but it's something that was carried over from Paul's time into our system now. But I think there is definitely value for us to do it as a system again.
Okay. I think one more picked up here. Do you coach differently when dealing with kids, especially under 14?
Yeah, no, definitely. I think the focus there is a lot more simple and a lot more basic. So obviously when we, and it's something that I almost forgot about again. So I think at one stage as a coach, as soon as you go into a high performance environment, you try to keep evolving and keep doing things in a different way. And sometimes you forget about the basics. And I think in our system as well, although you're working with senior guys, you still need to cover the basics, but that will probably take up 10% or 5% of your coaching time. Where with kids, I feel it's the other way around, where you need to keep coach the basics 95% of the time, and then obviously the more complicated stuff 5 or 10% of the time. And I think the biggest mistake that, in my opinion, that we're making at let's call it under 14 level and 15s especially, is we spend so much time on running moves and doing a game plan and patterns that we don't develop the individuals. So for me, it's all about developing that under 14 player, developing skill. And I always said, that's again, it's my opinion, if you have under 14 backline and they can pass the ball left and right in front of each other, so that they can run with pace onto the ball from a line out and a scrum, they will put a wing and give the wing space on the outside. I think they will beat 9 out of 10 times if they have that skill level and skill set, rather than to run fancy moves and patterns.
Okay, Thank you. What is a typical week leading into a tournament with regards to workload?
Yeah, listen, so obviously we do all our hard work back at home. So how it worked for us is we'll probably fly or basically fly on a Saturday or Sunday, then arrive in, let's call it Sydney on the Sunday or then the Monday, depending on the flight. And then we'll basically have the whole week before we start on a Saturday and Sunday with our tournament. So in that week, the workload, we take a lot back on the workload. So we will have the first 2 days will be more of a recovery. So Monday, Tuesday, more recovery. Wednesday, we'll probably have like one, or the Tuesday, we'll have one gym session and maybe a bit of a tech session. But it's almost a 4 or 5 out of 10 session. Wednesday, the guys will be off. Thursday, we will start pushing the intensity. So Thursday, we'll have a defense session, which will be a 60-minute session and about an 8, 9 out of 10. And then Friday, captain run, and then we play Saturday, Sunday. So all our hard work has been done here at SAS. As soon as we get onto the plane, we always have the idea that if we get on to the plane and we get off on the other side, we must be able to play a tournament already. So it's almost just enforcing one or two things a little bit, getting the guys out there to run through one or two moves more. But the hard work, all the stuff is done back at SAS. So I'll say in terms of load, it's really low key. So maybe one attack session, one gym session. And then the Thursday, 2 days before we start a tournament, we'll have a nice intense defense session. And then Friday, captain's and we play.
Okay. Just this 1 year, how important is role clarity in the Sevens culture?
Yeah, I think it is important, but again, it's also a case of how can I serve you? So yes, there's a role clarity in terms of what the head coach is doing and what the medical staff is doing and what the leadership group's job and responsibility is. But how can I help you in your roles and responsibilities? But that clarity is obviously important. So team selection and all that, the buck stops with me, with the doctor, the final call is with a, and not with a physio in terms of injuries and when the guys can return to the field. So that role clarity, I think, is important, but it's also a case of how can I serve you and how can I help you to make the system better.
Right. I think one final question. What is the relationship between Sevens and 15-man squad in terms of sharing players and knowledge?
Yeah, I think in South Africa, very good. I think it's something that we promote and try to build over the last few years. So I'm happy to have a good conversation with Job Nina, with the current head coach of the Springboks, or even with the Rassie, and sit down and talk about defense. And I think every time myself and Jock is talking about defense, it becomes a two-hour conversation where we share our ideas and our thinking about the game, and especially in defense. So, there's definitely a share of knowledge. There's definitely a flow over from 15s to 7s and 7s to 15s in terms of sharing players. So even now, as I speak, there's some of our 7s players that was just 7s contracted that will play in the domestic competition, Kirtley Ahrens, Angela Davids, some of our young up-and-coming talent that's probably going to do well for us in the next 2 years in sevens. We actually borrowed them to the unions to play in the Currie Cup now as well. Miller du Plessis with the Sharks. So yes, there's definitely a share of players, and also we also share knowledge. It's great to be able to sit with those guys, and I think for all the systems in South Africa, they will open a door. So if I want to go to the Sharks and see what they're doing there, they will be happy to receive me and have me around. And the same with them as well. I think there was a few coaches that said they want to spend some time with the Sevens, especially around the breakdown. So I'm more than happy to share our knowledge and how we see it with those coaches.
Okay. Neil, thank you very much. It's 3 minutes after 12. And then we'd like to respect your time. We want to thank you for taking an hour of your schedule. We know you're quite busy at this stage, preparing the boys to get ready for, we don't know really when the competition will start again, but that's applicable to everybody throughout the world. Thanks for sharing those insights, the values that instilling in a very successful Blitzbox team. And as you said, the topic was apt that we chose today in terms of how to build a successful team culture in a high-performance environment. Sometimes just going back to the basics and not looking too far ahead, to get the desired outcomes. Because I think as a nation, we are very focused on winning. And if you don't win, you're not successful. So this is a very enlightening session that we had with you. And I thank you very much for your time. Last but not least, just to the admin support that I've received, the Squan Mullins for all the admin behind the scenes, and then also Chanel and Angus from our ICT department at the university for making sure that we're up to date with the technology and all everything works. So thank you very much. I trust all the attendees enjoyed the session. There are maybe two or three questions that we didn't address, but we will then respond via email. But thank you, all the best, and enjoy the day further.
Thanks, Ram. Thanks for having me. Thank you.
Bye-bye.